December 16th, 2017. Breaking news reveals that the Defense Department secretly set up a program to investigate evidence of UFOs and alien life from 2007 to 2012 at a cost of $22 million.
This revelation sent an absolute shockwave through the UFO community. After years of denial, it emerged that the US government was indeed researching and investigating UFOs.
Along with the news, the Pentagon releases videos of encounters with unidentified flying objects. The video evidence electrifies the world. But is this the first time the Pentagon was secretly studying the UFO phenomenon, even while publicly saying for years that it had no interest in the subject? UFO researchers say no. They believe the military has been covering up what it knows about UFOs for over 70 years. The story begins on June 24, 1947, in Washington State near Mount Rainier, just 2 weeks before the famed UFO crash in Roswell. On this bright day with clear visibility, longtime pilot Kenneth Arnold is flying his privately owned utility aircraft.
Kenneth Arnold was an experienced pilot. There had been a missing aircraft that the military had put a reward out for, and he thought, well, I'll go out and I'll take a look.
It's at this critical point in time that the modern age of the UFO phenomenon is about to begin. So too, the era of conspiracy by the US military to suppress what the public knows about extraterrestrial spacecraft. Arnold is cruising at an altitude of 9,200 feet just before 3 o'clock in the afternoon when he sees a bright flashing light about 15 miles away.
And this was a day where there was good, clear visibility. And what Kenneth Arnold saw was 9 strange objects moving at high speed, flying apparently in formation.
He had the presence of mind to attempt to measure and calculate their distance and speed. He knew the distance between two particular peaks in the mountain range where he was, and he was able to time it.
At first, he thought maybe the speed was 1,200 miles per hour, but then later, it was calculated to be nearly 1,657 miles per hour. This was 3 times faster than any plane could fly in that time frame.
The Kenneth Arnold encounter is not only iconic, but it's also really revealing because this is the first time in the post-war era that we really have something that we could probably say is of possibly extraterrestrial origin. We're looking at a technology that appears to be far more advanced than anything we had at that time.
The next day, Arnold talks to the press, and the incident gains explosive nationwide news coverage. It's the first ever credible sighting of UFOs over the United States. And thanks to Arnold's description, the term flying saucer is born.
When Kenneth Arnold related the experience, he was asked by one of the reporters, how did these objects move? And he used the analogy, he said, like a saucer would if you skipped it across water. Now, the media got hold of that, and they used the term flying saucer. And in some quarters, that led to a misperception that Arnold had seen a saucer-shaped object, when in fact, it was more delta-shaped.
People really forget what a great witness Kenneth Arnold actually was. He was a private pilot in his 30s, and to everybody who knew him, he was a solid guy.
Arnold's claim gains even more traction when 2 eyewitnesses to the same sighting come forward.
The sighting was corroborated by a prospector on Mount Adams who saw these things. He claimed to see 6 of these objects on the same day at the same time.
And then there was a Forestry Service worker on fire watch who saw flashes in the sky at almost exactly the same time that Arnold had had his sighting. He also said the objects appeared to move in a straight line.
After a few weeks, Arnold submits a letter to Air Force Intelligence regarding his sighting.
Kenneth Arnold made a detailed report, and he included description and some very detailed sketches of the craft that he'd seen. Well, the military did an investigation, and they simply dismissed the whole thing and said it was a mirage. Well, that seems crazy to me. It just doesn't fit the facts.
Does it seem like the Air Force made a fair assessment, or is it possible the military attempted to suppress Arnold's story to prevent further dissemination of the facts? Fortunately for the public, further support for Arnold's UFO sighting appears just 2 weeks later, in early July 1947, over Phoenix, Arizona.
William Rhodes heard a strange noise, and he came out of his house with his camera, expecting to get a photo of a jet. And to his amazement, he saw this strange craft in the sky. He managed to get two photographs, and subsequently, the media published these with a story saying, here is photographic evidence of these so-called flying saucers.
Rhodes offers his photographs to the Arizona Republic, who publishes them on July 9th, 1947.
Subsequently, Kenneth Arnold saw that story and those photos, and he said, that's exactly what I saw.
A side-by-side comparison between Kenneth Arnold's sketches and William Rhodes' photos illustrates the uncanny similarities between the objects sighted. But then, within 48 hours of Rhodes' photos being published, two men show up to interview Rhodes, Lieutenant Colonel Beam and FBI agent Letting. Afterwards, Rhodes claims the men confiscated his film negatives. And when he calls the FBI, they deny all knowledge of the incident. Was this to destroy the evidence of UFOs? And is there a connection to sensational news of a UFO crash just 400 miles away at Roswell, New Mexico, reported the day before Rhodes' pictures were published? UFO investigators say one possible answer is that William Rhodes captured on film the same now-famous UFO that crashed in Roswell. And his experience with the government marks the beginning of an official conspiracy to cover up any evidence of UFOs. And despite the government's effort, the existence of off-world visitors becomes indisputable.
1952 was a year of UFO sightings that had been unparalleled ever. So in the United States, UFO sightings were so many and of such high quality, both by the general public and within the military, that it became a serious problem. And it was a problem that got the attention of all of the higher military agencies and the CIA. And by the later part of 1952, the question really was, how do we deal with this to contain this from a public relations point of view? Because it's a really difficult situation for government agencies and the military to have to deal with a public that is convinced that these flying saucers are real. And indeed, it was becoming more and more that way, because the fact was there were a lot of high quality, very difficult to explain UFO sightings from that year, and they were getting a lot of publicity.
Airline pilots with thousands of hours experience have reported saucers coming within a few hundred feet of their plane.
I glanced up and there were three flying saucers in a V.
So that's a problem. And what you see within the CIA is the development of an idea and is the convening of a classified body of scientists. We're talking Nobel caliber scientists who met for 1 week, for a couple of hours. It now appears, due to some very good historical research, that the conclusions of the panel were already set even before they met. Essentially to say that this is a problem that needs to be debunked in the public realm.
We have received and analyzed between 1,000 and 2,000 reports. There have been a certain percentage of this volume of reports that have been made by credible observers of relatively incredible things. We've been able to explain them as hoaxes, as erroneously identified friendly aircraft, as meteorological or electronic phenomena, or as light aberrations.